this week, I will say that this week means a lot. This week also is in coinciding with our national inauguration week. And so with the times very much shifting here in our nation, this week couldn't have come at a better time. When our committee sat in October to start planning this event took 3 months to plan, we were really thinking, how can we host Martin Luther King Week in this time, whoever the candidate may have been for our presidency? And when we were thinking of themes for this year, I asked our committee to really think about what they've been hearing in our classrooms, in our centers, and these words of fear, falsehood, and freedom really came to play. It was a constant theme in our brainstorms. And where do we go from here? Where do we go from here? It's, you know, it is the final book of Martin Luther King that he wrote. And so for us, being January 17, 2017, how do we move forward as a community, knowing all of the racial divide that's real, all of the Islamophobia, all of this classism and sexism that is going on not only here in our nation, but globally. So we as global citizens, how do we move forward with that? And with that is having conversations, challenging conversations. And so I hope that this week really does paint an illustration of what we're trying to have here, which is really being candid and real about what fear really means to a lot of you in this community sitting in this room right now. Falsehood, things that we have been promised that aren't here, and freedom. I had the honor of seeing Dr. Angela Davis last week, and she said that freedom is a constant struggle. Freedom is a constant struggle. And even though Dr. King has left us a beautiful messages of challenging in that, how do we become of that part of conversation? And so I hope that MLK Week is the beginning, if not a continuation, of having these real candid conversations of where we're heading at today, because the road ahead is not easy. This work wouldn't be possible without an incredible committee that I had planning this week after week. So I would definitely love to give a big thank you to Dr. Joe Bryce, Jody White, Dominique Austin, Aisha Valencia, Ashray Brown, Billy Chandler, Erin Modica, Osama Khalili, Nestor Nguera, Bopa Chang, Michael Tooncap, and Bevan Taylor. Without y'all, this week wouldn't be possible. So if y'all could please give them a round of applause. So if I would like to invite Billy Chandler and Erin Modica to introduce Dr. Maxine Mimms.
You know, as I think about our theme for this Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. weekend, fear, falsehood, and freedom, right? And where do we go from here? It makes me happy that we are here today at Highline to pay tribute to a man of vision, faith, and activism. It makes me think of how education plays a critical role in movements for liberation. When I think about the long Black freedom movement here throughout in our nation's history, I think about what Ella Baker once said. Oppressed people, whatever their level of formal education, have the ability to understand and interpret the world around them, to see the world for what it is, and move to transform it. So today, Billy and I have the honor of introducing a woman who has worked to transform the lives of students and communities through her teachings, Dr. Maxine Mimms, our keynote speaker for the 2017 Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. Week here at Highline. Dr. Mimms is a phenomenal Black woman, activist, educator, mentor, elder in our community, and overall special person who has worked continually to challenge others to discover their own identity and to empower the communities in which they live.
Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King believed that civil rights activism will give society a new sense of values in order to solve the particular problems of economic and racial oppression. Dr. Mimms carried that challenge forward. After teaching both the Seattle and Kirkland school system during the 1950s and 60s, she joined the faculty of Evergreen State College in 1972. While teaching at Evergreen, she responded to the black residents' demand in higher education in Tacoma. Following the legacy of Mary McCloy Bethune, the first black woman to found a college of black students in 1904, Dr. Mimms focused on developing a higher...
Excuse me, 1904?
Yeah.
I knew Abraham Lincoln, but honey, don't...
No, that was
1972.
No, it was Mary...
Oh. Oh. My Lord. Excuse me, Billy, I'm sorry, but, oh, no. Bad enough, but, oh.
Following the legacy of Mary McLeod Bethune, the first black woman to found a college of black students in 1904,
okay.
Dr. Mimms focused on developing an educational program that would serve working adults in Tacoma's largely African American hilltop neighborhood. Initially teaching adult learners out of her home using her own resources, in 1982, Dr. Mimms formally founded the Tacoma campus of Evergreen State College in 1982, where she served as executive director until her retirement in 1990. Today, the Tacoma program is known for improving access to higher education for working adults with an emphasis on community building. In 2001, Dr. Mimms was awarded the first annual Sustainable Community Outstanding Leadership Award. Recently, Mimms founded the Dr. Mimms Academy, a nonprofit organization in Tacoma's hilltop neighborhood established to serve youth expelled and suspended from public schools. Most recently, Dr. Mimms received the 2017 Dr. Martin Luther King Community Service Award. Please stand up. And help us welcome Dr. Maxine Mimms.
Oh, thank you, thank you. Do I go over here? Yeah, thank you. I guess I better open one of these. Thank you. I gotta sit down, so you all sit down. Oh, what a beautiful audience. You know, when I stand in front of a modern day audience and see this, I get very sad that Dr. King couldn't see it. You know? He would have been 88 Sunday. I'm already 88. I'll be 89 in March. And so we were from that same period. And I'm privileged to just, oh my gosh, look at this. Somebody tells you I wasn't even listening, or maybe I couldn't even hear it, that you were born in 1904. I thought, oh no, that's a falsehood. Let me correct it now. Because knowing that, it'll put fear in me. But it's just so wonderful to see people that I knew as babies. I knew Atlanta, where are you? As a baby. I know the trustee, Debrina, as a baby. Who else? I didn't know Teresa as a baby. Adira. Oh my gosh, before she was born. And it's just wonderful. I'm gonna sit down now. Because I don't wanna lecture. I'm tired of it. I've been in this business of lecturing for a long time. And I know my contract, Madam Director of Multicultural, I'm gonna break it. The only way to move forward is to be bold. Because I wanna have a dialogue. I don't want the straight lecture. And a lot of times, people as important as I am in the world, hear that? That's how you start falsehoods. But I feel very good having been blessed to live to be this age. And you don't often get a chance to do an intergenerational dialogue because most of the time it's teacher, student, grandmother, grandchild. You know what I'm saying? And I want an opportunity because I love Highline. It is the greatest looking place. Is it a good school? I saw your hand, little bald head right there. Intergenerational respect. Tall, short. Ah, what a beautiful sight. Who's the tallest one in here? Basketball, is it basketball? Scholarship from where? Here. Okay. The shortest one in here. Soccer? Yeah. Well, listen, let's have, could I move this thing up a closer? Because it's so far back. It's too far back. Let's have a dialogue. Because in order to deal with that theme, which is interesting for me, fear, and I know you all know that you've heard it so much in your temples and your Sunday schools, it's false evidence appearing with real. How many of you have heard that? Yeah, yeah. And it produces, but at a certain age, you just got to get rid of it. I can't have it. You know what I mean? I'm too close. I'm 12 years from 100, so why should I continue to have it? Okay, I mean, what's there for me to fear? I've been through it all. Ain't nothing to fear but somebody saying I was born in 1904. You know, I got to make sure my hearing is sharp. You know, so I can't get a lot of technology. When Billy is introducing me, I have to make sure I can hear right. I have to make sure I can come in this room and have my legs at this thing walk right. I have to make sure I don't use a cane too early. I don't use a walking stick too early. I have to make sure I can sit here, concentrate on getting up. You know, now, slowly, but getting up. I have to be able to move and walk among you. Because if I don't, guess what I will fear? I will fear being hurt or dying. I will fear what the medical alert people say. I have fallen and can't get up. I hear it. Every day. I'm getting my mail from AARP telling me how fearful it is to be in my own house. You know, can't take a bath. It's telling me you have to be funky all the time. Because if you get in the bathtub, you'll get in there. Nobody will find you. Nobody will call you. Can you imagine sitting in your own home watching television and you're being told constantly, you're gonna fall, you can't get up. After that commercial is on, then the other commercial is on, don't leave your family in debt, be cremated. That produces fear and you become paralyzed. So therefore I don't have television, I've never had television. I don't even look at it. Because your images designed by somebody else will always make you fearful. Will always. And if you aren't careful, the images that begin to control you will make you do some harm to yourself. Now, I have to create an environment of inconvenience so that I can learn to be safe. You understand what I'm saying? In your classrooms, you have to create an environment of disagreeing with the author of the books that you're reading so that you can become a critical thinker through yourself. Disagree with every author. Disagree with are you a faculty? Are you a president or something? Disagree with this entire group of people, not publicly, but so that you can begin to grow and help to reduce fear in the world. or you will begin to believe that November 8th was true. See, November 8th is an illusion. Let me sit down now, and we'll talk about that. Because what happened to us, back to the AARP magazine, Maxine, if you fall down, you can't get up. What Maxine did was, after my friend Martin Luther King did the great work, when I began to ritualize the speech, I have a dream, I became complacent. I became comfortable. Then, for me, Barack Obama became president. I leaned back further. Oh, Maxine, you're doing it now. I crossed my legs. I became Madame Rip Van Winkle. I went to sleep. And when I woke up, it was November the 9th. The revolution had occurred, and I was asleep. Be careful with your dreams, because if you become complacent with them, you will wake up to a nightmare. And we have awakened on November the 9th to a nightmare. What can Maxine do with that now? You talk about where do we go from here. I can take that nightmare and turn it into a positive collaboration and do something about it and become ever more active. I can take my 88-year-old self with all the years I've been on Earth and translate that into some sort of positive contribution to make sure that November the 9th isn't real for me. You follow what I'm saying? Because I don't believe when I fall in my house, I can't get up. You can't believe that when you stumble, you can't get up. So I'm gonna spend a little time with you, and I'm gonna lean back and drink some water and talk. So whoever is the boldest person, ask something so we can have a conversation. Oh, aren't you nice? How old are you?
I'm 37.
I was born in 1904. Let's talk. Yes, sir, right here. Sir, right here. I don't know any names. Now listen, and like I said, sir, when an older person points to you, it may not even be you, it may be the other one. So just wait until I do it twice. So you, yes. Yes, sir. And I can hear pretty good. See, if they can't move, that's okay. I don't want them to feel shy about it. Yes, sir.
I guess the question I have to ask is, how exactly do you feel about the current situation that we are having Trump and all that is going around in America?
I think it's a gift to us. The gift is that I'm here. And the gift is that the gift was Maxine. Now, by the way, Christmas gifts, I didn't get a lot of Christmas gifts because my daddy killed Santa Claus. And I didn't know nothing about Santa Claus. But when you get a gift, have you ever gotten a gift you didn't want?
No.
No, no. Well, okay, a lot of times you'll get a gift that you don't want. And what we just got was a gift, but it was a gift. Some of us got a gift that we wanted. Some of us got a gift that we're agitated about. They talk about ugly sweaters and ugly ties. And when you talk about the content of the person, which Dr. King always talked about, your content is so powerful, and you're such a genius and so brilliant. You cannot take that brilliant gift, that genius gift, and meet something that is unworthy. You're going to attract that you are. First, you've got to feel very good about yourself. in order to live with these next few years. They're not going to be long, they're going to be short. And as you get older, your years are shorter anyhow. Summers are very short, winters are very long. The older you get, the less sun you see. Believe you me, because you fall down and can't get up. But you've got to take that beautiful handsomeness of yourself and take it forward. You've got to form a club or an organization or a conversation, and you all have to sit around and talk about the greatness of the three or four of you and how you would make a contribution to the society. What you're going to do at Highline to make it a better place, what you're going to do for the state of Washington, and you start that tomorrow morning. You don't wait for anything. You start it tomorrow morning. You raise your hand in a sociology class or a psychology class and say, I'm ready to make a contribution to whatever academic discipline you're interested in and focus it, but begin to focus on something that helps reduce whatever that is up there. In fact, after today, you don't even take that language with you. Where do you go from here? You make an analysis of your inward self and move forward with confidence and power. You become the president tomorrow morning. You have your own inauguration. Put on some fancy clothes and march around in your own house. Put on some boots and get you a purple cap. Put it on your head and say, make it myself great again. Reduce it. And once you reduce the external pressures on you, then you will be able to move forward no matter what. Okay. Yes, sir.
You said that this election was an illusion.
Yes.
And I think that a lot of people are starting to realize that politics is an illusion for change and that these people don't necessarily control it. And
don't necessarily control. Yeah, crazy people can control you.
Unless you let them.
Yeah. But I'm saying, if the medical alert tells me in my own house that when I fall down, my children aren't going to knock on the door, I can't get up. Now, if I structure my life around falling down and getting up, if I don't arrange my house and prepare with an inconvenience, a practice falling down and practice getting up, I will be down there. Because I don't know it's an illusion, because according to the thing the television has told me, and so does the research from the medical alert people. Okay, go ahead. Come here. I'm gonna show you how. What do you think your major is? What do you think you're focusing on?
Well, I personally don't. I'm just learning. That's really what I'm doing.
I don't hump your shoulders. What do you think you're focusing
psychology.
On?
Psychology.
You think you're focusing on psychology? You have any other brothers around you focusing on the same thing?
No, I don't.
Would you like to have some?
Yes.
Meet me this afternoon with three other brothers and form yourself the psychology organization against negative falsehoods. You form it tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning. You form it this afternoon. Form it while I'm here. Find three others. That's it. You've done. You've counteracted everything. You've counteracted the fear, your body language. You put your shoulders back, and you know you're the greatest. Are you the greatest psychologist student in America?
No.
Yes, you are. You can't say that to an 88-year-old woman. You have to say, yes, I am. Because when you give me that, guess what I leave with? It helps me walk a little taller and a little stronger to my car. I need you. You are now my teacher. So I don't need you to say, I need you to know. When I walk out here, I'll say, I met a man. Got it? Tomorrow morning, the psychology organization will be formed, and your name is?
Jarrell.
Jarrell's organization of psychology, black male psychologists in the United States. And then you're able, with next election, you all will be going to the White House to talk about the culture and the psychology of Black America.
I don't think I would.
I don't. But see, you can't say that to me, though.
That's still falling into the illusion of politics.
No, no, no. We're having a good dialogue. Because you're just deciding you don't want to be strong, and you can't do that with me. I'm too old for that now. You are strong and so great, that's why you're standing there with locks in America, coming from under a wool cap and white tennis shoes. You all right, brother? You look good. When you're so great and so gorgeous, sometimes it's embarrassing. How many of you ever experienced that? Yeah, yeah. You want to shy away. You want to shy away. You would like to have an illusion, but you're so powerful, you break all the illusions. You see what I'm saying? Yeah, I mean, locks and a wool cap at Highline and white tennis shoes in the winter? Come on, brother. You all right with me? Who else? Yes, sir. These are the I'm glad to be here, y'all. Where is the vice president? You got some mighty nice looking young men here. One of the things, because, I'll say this, I'm gonna get ready. And I think I'm going to do it too at Evergreen. We need to look at our men and our women and our trans or whatever it is. And we need to try with self-identity, if you want to do that, and form something so the dialogue can be increased. We've got to increase the dialogue around race, ethnicity, gender, all of that, so that we can feel very confident about who we are going forward. Because it's where do you go from here? It's very difficult to go from here if the identity doesn't have confidence. You know, Maya Angelou says, and still I rise. If you don't have a convenient place to rise, it ain't no and still I rise, you see? So you have to, and you've got some beautiful stuff here. And I don't know what kind of, the schedules, because it's a lot of work in adults, and I understand that. But we need some space in higher ed that allows us to give freedom to this kind of beauty. And we're not giving freedom to what I call ethnic beauty. We're giving freedom to ethnic struggle. And ethnic struggle keeps you moving along, doing something. We've got to give some freedom to ethnic exotic stuff, ethnic elegance, ethnic beauty, ethnic intellectualism. We've got to do something and elevate the discourse in a way that the confidence. These are, I don't know if it's because I'm old, but some of these men look good. You know, I'm serious, you all, you know, and it may be my eyesight. You have to let me know later. Yes, sir, I'm sorry, sir. What's your major?
I'm just getting my AA.
Didn't ask that. I said, what's your focus tonight? Let's focus.
My focus is social psychology.
Social psychology. Go ahead, sir.
My name is Seth Davis. Seth Davis.
S-E-T-H?
Mm-hmm. And I'm part of the Umoja program. I'm a Umoja scholar. And everybody, there's some point that not everybody reaches, but sometimes you get that one person that reaches, it's that gets that click in his mind, like it's time for me to stand up and try to make a change. So my question is for you, where was that click for you? What was your motive? Like when did it come clear that you needed to stand up and say, I want to be, instead of complaining, I want to be the change that I seek?
That's very good. I don't really know. I was born in the segregated South. I drank out of segregated water fountains. But my father would never let us drink water because he didn't want us to, he was a Garveyite, and he didn't want us with the segregated water fountains. I didn't go to the movies until I was in college, because in the segregated South, whites sat in the lower, and blacks sat up here. If it was a fire in the theater, my daddy always talked about there was going to be a fire in the theater. I thought theaters had nothing but fires. You had no exit. You had to come down the steps to go out. So I never was allowed to go to the theater. Even until today, I don't walk on the sidewalk. I walk in the street. Because in the street, on the sidewalk, you had to get off the sidewalk to let white people pass. And you walked in the street, and you held your head down. My father didn't allow that. We walked in the street, so we never had to get off the sidewalk. And I never rode a bus, because he was not going to let us go through the back door. So when Martin Luther King, with the bus boycott, I met friends from people from all over the country. They talked about paying your money in the front and going through the back. Sissy Tyson is a very good friend of mine, and she talked about playing Miss Jane Pittman. And I said, well, Cicely, how did you get your mouth ready to drink that water? She said she went and practiced what other black women had told her, how you had to have the mouth because the fountain was low, and how you had to bend to get the water in to keep from spilling it on the floor, because if you did let some go on the floor, they'd put you out of the place. Born in the segregated South makes you very alert at all times that you've got to make a change. It isn't a choice. I mean, I didn't know there was a separation between high school and college. I just knew you started in school and you went on to college. I mean, I didn't know all of this. So the choices that the quote unquote North gives you, for example, an interesting thing with people of color in the Pacific Northwest, it's very difficult to be real successful in a lot of academic institutions because you struggle. The Pacific Northwest causes you to struggle in an extra thing when you're a person of color because of the weather. The weather, we're show out type people. We like to move and dance and dress and dah, you know. Ain't no sun out there to do all that, and you can't do that in no rain. We want the exotic clothes on. I still like it, but there's nowhere to show out. So I just come here and put on all my stuff. But the rain makes me have on a coat, umbrella, hat, and draw. So I don't see you often enough to say, hi, how are you? I'll see you soon. Where there's sun, you can do that. And where there's sun, you can study together. In the Pacific Northwest, you have to study alone a lot because of the rain. So the dialogue isn't enhanced. So a lot of times you have great difficulty, not because the subject is hard, it's because you're lonely in your with your studies. So you have to provide an atmosphere for yourself. And that's why you have, that's why they, let me say this, but they're streaming this. Where does it go when it's streaming? But I was going to say, that's why they had to legalize weed. You know, because it was, who's here? You're looking at me hard. But you know what I'm saying? It isn't, you have to find, in the Pacific Northwest, you're always looking for something artificial to make you survive. And what we've got to do is bring our sun to ourselves so that we can endure. Bring your sun to you. Let the sun shine in with you and a couple of more fellas in psychology. Have you all talked a lot about what you want to do in order to make my life better? So you want to keep me alive. You want to keep your mothers and your grandmothers and your aunts alive. You want to major in those things that keep me alive. You've got to find ways to make sure my life, you've got to find another way to say when you fall down, Maxine, you can get up. And you need to invent something that gets me up. You need to go into the psychology of growing older and bring some sun into my life so that I can live. You're all about getting me to live. making me live, and your grandparents and stuff. So you're ready right now. Tomorrow morning you're ready. This afternoon I'll still be here. I'll help you put it together. Done. And it's good. You're a good-looking young man.
I appreciate it.
I mean, girl. Anything else? See, once you get the confidence, you want to ask another question, go on, sit down. I'll get to you, because I'm going to be here all day, I know. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Dr. Hi. Maxine Mimms. So you spoke about the discussion about identity. And as not only a Moja Scholar student, but as well as a president of a cultural club, Black Student Union. I was wondering, as a culture, what topics around or what discussion around identity would you claim to be vital?
You've got to do colorism, you've got to do hair, fat, short, gender, aging. We need to try, and I don't know whether you could get it in. But I would like to see a lot of the culture clubs now going back to an old civics model. There has to be something that we've got to really structure about civility. And I don't know what to do with that yet. I'm going to work with that. I think I'm on to something. I was thinking thinking about what is it that I could do a little better in the conversations that I'm beginning to have with people. I think I'm going to do a little bit with cooperation and competition. I don't know whether I have reached a point in my elderhood, if you will, where I can now just simply talk about collaboration and cooperation. And I think that privilege comes with aging. I don't know what to do with competition because I'm too old now to be. Who am I going to be? Everybody I know is dead, you know, practically, you know. And when I get to the younger crowd, I think I've got to do a little bit more sophisticated work with competition. How do I do that and allow those C's? And I think cooperation, collaboration, and communication has to be something that I'm going to have to work on because I'm really leaving the world of competition and judgment and cynicism. You see what I'm saying? As you age, as you begin to age, some of that stuff begins to go because it's not healthy for you. And how do I translate that into a language that younger people will understand? I don't know what to do with, I don't know whether they talk about getting rid of it, which would reduce a lot of that, right. Or whether to leave it in, and I don't know whether there's healthy competition. I think there is, and that's what I want to work with. But I think in terms of the culture, I want some civility in the culture now, because we've got some divisiveness. And the language is unhealthy, you know. And you're too young to be wallowing in the unhealthy language because all you'll do is just make yourself have some skills for survival. And you don't want that. You want some skills to be critical, but learn how to be critically and endure, you see, so you can move over, you know. Yeah. Does that help you at all?
Yes, it does.
You're another beautiful one.
Thank you.
And that Highline may be just recruiting gorgeous people of color now. There's some mighty pretty looking people in here. And if that's happening, you need to check that out, Madam Culture Lady. Check it out and see if you're alert. They may only be getting pretty people of color in the school, and maybe all the other campuses. And maybe that's a good piece. Or maybe all the other campuses have nothing but ugly people. And that may be a form of competition that we need to work with. Anything else, please? Oh, come on. Yes, sir. Oh, cameraman. Yes, sir.
Hi. You said earlier, be careful with your dreams, because if you become complacent with them, they can turn into something bad or fears. As all of us, as students of higher education, how that tension resonates with us, and how can that help us become more productive members of society, I guess?
Yeah, keep some internal agitation. stay inside, and keep some of that going on. Maxine, with the mark, you know, I became very comfortable with civil rights. I didn't do anything with the language with Maxine. I stayed with that language too long. I should have been able to go, Maxine should have been able to go through the work and gotten to human rights. Civil, human. So I would have identified my humanity and identified that her as a human. But I stayed so long with civil rights, I went to race, ethnicity, and forgot about the human rights. You see, so I didn't, in my lecturing and all of the stuff that I was dealing with younger people, I didn't move myself early enough to help move them from civil to human. And I went to sleep, and I woke up, and we got what we got. I'm responsible for that election on November the 8th. Because sleeping, getting comfortable, not, in the old days, there was an old wash machine, and you would hear the old people say, honey, turn it on so it can agitate the clothes, and it went like that. We need to have a form of agitation so we won't stay in the dream for so long and ignore the possibility of a November the 8th.
Thank you.
Yes. Yes, sir. And by the way, we're dealing with collective trauma right now. That's all it is. It you know, psychologists, how many are in psychology in here? Write some papers on getting rid of collective trauma and pass them out to the campus.
So easy to concentrate on the negatives amongst us, racially, age, weight, whatever you want to do. We can pick each other apart forever. But I realized a while back, my niece, kind of the love of my life, is 8 years old. She's never known a time where there isn't or couldn't be at least a black president, a female. Anybody else in the room could be president if they really want to. That I think Dr. King would be incredibly proud of. What else do you see as the positive gains that have been made since Dr. King? You and I wouldn't have sat comfortably in the same room back at his time. And I'm so glad that we can now.
Martin Luther King would have come down the freeway and driven up to Highline, walked into this turtle building, and burst into tears because this is the dream. No, we don't know. I don't know. Wouldn't know the names. You don't know the names. Don't know anything about you. Other than physically, all we're seeing is the physical. All we're seeing is the outer skin. Then the chair is here. People are coming to the mic. And as people are coming to the mic, then the content of the character begins to manifest itself. So the content of Highline is manifesting itself as the young man there, the young man from there, the young lady, and you, and in this role. And the content, and if you just keep with the dialogue, if you keep with the conversation, da-da-da-da, it just expands. Without the dialogue, we'll close down. Mm-hmm. And that's why we're so frustrated right now. We can't get the dialogue because the fear from all of our news is to say, be careful, be fearful, there's a revenge put in there. So the collective trauma of how to be, we're being trained how to be fearful of each other. Mm-hmm. And we've got to break that. And you break that by having some conversation every day with somebody that's different. Mm-hmm. Every day, yeah. Just try, hey there, or something, you know. Because that's why I told you the story about I fell down and I can't get up. Once I'm trained to fall down in my own house, I'm not gonna get up, you all. Now, I'm not being trained by anybody. I'm looking at television. So I call the 1-888-999-6664, and my medical alert comes. And after I get that medical alert, that is not quite the right medical alert. So I keep on, until I am sitting in a chair all day long and will never be able to get up in order to fall. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so you've got to expand your conversation so your content can grow. And you just look around. I see nothing but skin coloring right now. I see differences in terms of the external. But with the dialogue, you expand it.
I spoke to you earlier. One of my favorite sayings from my mom the past few years ago, she says, "Who says that one person can't make a change?" And I look at somebody such as yourself. You didn't get into this to be who you are today. That wasn't the thought. You got into it to correct a situation, to make things a little better.
I don't know why I got into it.
And I want to say on behalf of all of us, thank you for being who you are.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, thank you. Oh, my God. You know, and you know what? Let me tell you something. And I appreciate you all coming with these clothes. I have never seen, these jeans that are cut all across the legs. I'm beginning, by the way, to like them. I'm going to have on some the next time I speak to you all. I didn't like it at first. You know, I didn't. But did you do those yourself? You go buy them. And see, that's the insanity. You see, you have some material. My segregated South, we could have never done that, you know. You are just, and look at the shoes. Look how gorgeous. How are you doing? You all look so beautiful. Go ahead with your question. Highline has told you all to write, how to teach you all how to write questions on the paper.
Thank you very much. I think you look beautiful as well.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, train them, girl.
My question to you is, recalling what you said that fear is something that we must get rid of because the images defined by somebody else will always make us fearful. What's your advice on the fear of love?
What is my what?
Your advice on fear of love, self-love.
Fear of love? Mm-hmm. It's impossible. It's impossible. When it's coming towards you, you can't, I love you. Come on. You can't stop it. You can't stop it. You will spend some time trying to stop it, but you can't. It's so powerful. That's all it is. That's all it is. And that's what we are trying to avoid. In a collective trauma situation that happened the 8th and the 9th or whatever it is, or on the 20th, you're not looking at a person that feels love. You're looking at a person that feels fear. And it's very sad. I've been in education a long time. I've seen fearful children. I've seen children with confidence. At this age, I know what I'm seeing. And I have an obligation to say, love is the answer for all of it. And when you're not loved, you end up having an illusion of a political situation. And you tweet and Twitter with the characters that confines you because you're not free enough to be free. And thank you. And what you are experiencing, and that's why you have to now run for office tomorrow morning. You have to file papers and run for something. You have to go to the president of the college and say, I would like to shadow you for the next 2 weeks. I would like to find out what a president does, you know, and be up in the office and let the psychologist come and talk to you and say, man, how was it? And that language has to permeate the campus or permeate other friends so that you will never have a nightmare or collective trauma Because what you have going into office in our country right now is a young boy that was neglected by me in education. And as a result, the revenge for my inability to teach him to love himself manifests itself after 70 years in a rejection of the entire space. But you don't have to be a part of it, because you really are our president. You are really being inaugurated. You are the new man on the block, jeans and all. And when you understand that, then you get back to your classes and say, "Ooh, I have an obligation and a responsibility to work toward that goal, because someday I'm it." You're tall and you got it.
Wise words. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah, right here. Yes, ma'am.
So I just was curious if you could give some advice to us here about what we can do going away from this meeting to set our own goals. What can we do as students to define success for ourselves?
All right. Why did you put that thing around you? What is it called?
I don't know.
What do you think is pretty on you? No, don't do that. See, what happens is you get up in the morning and put this on you. Somebody asks you, "I don't know." You do know. Why did you put that on?
My hair is a mess.
No.
That's the reason.
To compliment yourself. Do you think you look good in it?
I do.
So there is an image of yourself that you have now, because this morning you did something to yourself. Okay, you did something to make yourself look elegant. So today, get with a group of friends and form the Elegant Club for about 20 minutes, or the Elegant Gathering, or the Elegant Dialogue, and call it the girls with the bands around the hair. And for a week, wear bands. And when you find out the dialogue, what are bands? I don't know, what are hair bands, or where do you buy this, or where is it? Your conversation will expand. What's the research on that? Why, you know, go to the physics department and find how much air is it in your hair. When you discover from yourself how many academic disciplines you are, do you realize that you're single being about 50 different disciplines? And you just make, you know, shoes, Uggs. Can you imagine somebody paying $200, $300, and $500 for something that's called ugly? That's a psychology department dilemma right there. Can you imagine buying jeans that you cut? You know, what's ugly for me has become beautiful for you. So what I have to do as I age, you have to teach me how to reduce my cynicism and my judgment. And the more I delayer that stuff and get it off of me, the less I'm going to fall down in my own house. The more mess I keep in me, the more I'm going to fall in my own house. And if I got a whole bunch of mess on me, I ain't going to be able to get up. So the medical alert people make a lot of money off of me by me having a judgment about you. Judgments, cynicism, and all that will weigh you down and create hell. So form the band club, the Blue Band Club, and you got are those Uggs?
They are, yes. Oh.
Hi.
My name is Salome. And I love your outfit.
Thank you. Salome?
Yes, Salome. So my question is, where I come from, there's a saying that says that...
Where are you from?
I'm from Kenya.
Kenya?
Yes.
I went there straight for 15 years. I worked in Kisumu.
Wonderful. The best lakes are on that side, so you must have had a good time. So the saying is, A young boy on top of a tree cannot see as far as a man, an old man seated on a stool. That's what they say. So my grandfather said that all the time, and I asked him before he passed away what he meant by that, because in my eyes, the young man is on top of a tree, so he can see far.
That's right.
And the old man is on a stool, so he's way below the ground, so he can't see far. And he said that there's, with aging, there's wisdom from the history of where we come from, and there's also wisdom in knowing where we are going, which a young man doesn't have either.
Right.
So as a lady who has seen the history of people of color and how far we've come, I believe you know where we need to be and where we are going. And you said today that we are living the dream that Dr. King had when he spoke and said he has a dream. So my question is, what do we have to do to keep this dream a reality for ourselves and for every child of color who's gonna be born in this country? What do you think we need to do, and where are we failing in keeping this dream alive? Thank you.
You're not failing. Back to what they would say in Kenya. If you keep me healthy by your being alive, if I can always see you, then it will cause me to stand up straight. When I'm bent over, I'm causing you to be bent over. But when I stand up straight, and you help me to stand up straight, and you stand over my shoulders, you can see much further than I can see. And if you stand up straight, that one that's going on your shoulders. So you always need ancestral understanding in order to move through a situation like this. When exam week, so you still have exams here? I didn't know. I don't know. Exam week, call on your ancestors to take you through it. Call on your ancestors to take you through it. You'll be surprised how your grades will change if you depend on your ancestors to give you some wisdom through that type of thing.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Hi, my name is Dan. I'm a former police officer, retired, and I'm having fun going to school with all these terrific young people and trying to learn some new stuff. And I appreciate what you're giving. I apologize for coming in late. I bet you nobody asked this question this morning, but in light of everything that's happened in the last 3 or 4 years, I'll give you an opportunity to do this. Black lives do matter. What do you think about blue lives?
Blue lives? I believe that black matter lives. Now just black matter lives. We had to go to Black Lives Matter. Because remember now, I gave you something earlier. You have to always go to complete extreme in America because of Western disciplines. Western education excludes. And it isn't a design, it's just an ignorance of what it is. It excludes. Not necessarily always by design. Back in the southern part of the country, yes, by design. And we've got that in us. And about what I just told you about delayering, we did not have the language to talk about police brutality because you would be killed in discussing that publicly. And that is the fear. So the young people said, Maxine, older people, because we went, as I said earlier, civil rights, and we didn't lead it to human rights. We stayed with the civil rights in that language. Right now, what is marvelous about you is you're saying to Maxine, I understand black lives matter, but what about blue lives? Now, if I didn't have to go home, you and I could have a cup of coffee together and talk to each other with a conversation about the colors, blue and black. And that conversation would lead us both to a growth. We never had the time. We always have, I fell down and I can't get up. And that's where we're trapped.
Well, let's make the time. The world's becoming a small place. I'll come have coffee with you anytime.
Now you're flirting.
Ah, you're on to me. So I got to tell you, and it has nothing to do with any of the unrest that has happened, but unfortunately a member of my crew did pass away, and so
yes.
I did go to Washington, D.C., and I did
Absolutely.
Go I did go through the week, you know, every year.
Now, I want to show you how you can do something here. How old are you?
You're kicking me out of the closet.
It doesn't matter.
51.
All right. Now, you are at Highline. You heard two young males talk about being in the field of psychology. Have coffee with them and a bowl of Jell-O. You'd be surprised. Jell-O we all hate, but it's pretty. It's just pretty. You want something pretty on the table as you're discussing something. Always have something pretty. Because when you're discussing heavy things, you want something pretty. And yellow Jell-O is good. That brings the sun.
I won't consume all your time. I would just want to leave you with one thing. And many of the people that went to that law enforcement week when I was there, I want to tell you, we got this tough face and hard whatever. But I want you to know something. We're people, too, and we do have hearts, and we do feel it. And it's just hurtful, and the hearts are breaking. And I know that's true
right.
on both sides.
You're right. You're right. But sir, listen, and that's where the dialogue. I'm so glad. Young psychology student, and there's another one psychology. Be sure you all get together. Blue and black lives, and then I'll ask the board of trustees, Ms. Debrina Jackson-Ganley, to. Let y'all present to the board. Black Lives Matter thoughts. It's thought, but you have to have a conversation. If you don't have a conversation, you will fall on the floor and you won't be able to get up because the literature will make you think that. The dialogue has to be. And you're in the right place where you would get the support. You're hurting, and so is he. And the triggering of November the 8th for me was so devastating for me after all these years. But I have to move beyond. I had to accept that gift and do something about it. And by the way, I don't know whether I want to unwrap it or not. Got to work on that. I may pull the string slower, or I might pull it faster, and I might stomp on the gift. I don't know, but I've got work to do. Okay. Yeah, you've got work to do. Really hard work. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes. Okay. Billy, you all better let me know about the time now. I got 15 minutes. Thank you, ma'am.
I just want to say it's a pleasure seeing you again. I was at the ladies' tea at NAMM about a year and a half, maybe 2 years ago. Had the pleasure of seeing you there. Speaking of fear, I just want to say I'm a mother of a 9-year-old son. He's my middle child. And the fear I have is not for myself. The fear I have is for my son. Not only as I'm raising him to walk in his truth and in his strength, I also have to raise him now because of the just rampant just fear of my son's life, for my son's life, and how he'll perceive, and I gotta teach my son what not to
Stop watching television as of today. Stop
I don't watch television.
Stop it.
I actually don't
It will
watch
drive
television.
You
it's
crazy.
Everywhere.
You will see a child shot in St. Louis, run, grab your right. child, and say it's going to happen.
Right. I actually
join the blue. Join the blue black club that they're starting tomorrow morning. Get with some sociologists and some psychologists and look at the culture of black males in America. We've got to go beyond. I raised two sons out here, and it's not easy. But you cannot watch television. You cannot. Get rid of your televisions.
And now Facebook, because that's actually where
I said.
I don't watch television. I don't watch television.
Your image, wait, all I'm trying to say, it may not even be you. That's all I'm trying to say. It may not even be you. It may be Sally in Chicago.
Right.
And we hurt for that. But you have an obligation to form a group of mothers who have raised sons, or whatever it is. You may be mothers of nine-year-olds, I don't know. But do something tomorrow morning, this afternoon. Turn off the televisions, turn off this, and re-image. Image, re-image, and shift the premise so that you can be free to raise your son. You're doing a beautiful job. Is this son of Pacific Northwest? What school?
He goes to Kent School District, Covington Elementary.
Oh, Kent is fine. Kent's fine. Kent's fine. Okay. They don't even shoot in Kent. Right here. Yes, ma'am.
I always want to defer to a student, but I'll take this moment. My name is Liz Word, and I am... I'm the coordinator of the Emoja program, and so there are some of my students around here. I teach communication studies, and one, I want to thank you for your presence here, and just the energy that you bring into this room, into this campus. Your legacy precedes you in this area, and all of our dear friends in Atlanta who have spoken about you. And I want to thank you also for the Evergreen State College Tacoma, where we send our graduates.
Oh, yeah.
And having a beautiful HBCU right in our backyard is very powerful. Some of the things that you touched on today are practices in the Emoja community, the ethic of love, manifesting, building communal intelligence, and all of those things as we move forward, forgetting this fear, falsehood, and freedom, but as we move forward with love and possibility. As an Emoja community, we want to invite you to always be part of our community. We know that we can learn from our elders and learn from the people who have come before us. And I want to ask if there is one thing, one word, that you could describe your experience with Sankofa, right? And with building Evergreen State College or building educational programs for black students in the Pearson King County area. If there's one word that, or a few words, that could help as we continue to build our Emoja program that we need to think about and keep ever present, what would those words be?
Creativity. Be creative. See yourself as gifted and exotic. It's a little hard to do because you have, I told you, the rain makes you, you're not always out waving and, you know, saying hello and with bright colors. And it's a little hard, but do something exotic for yourself every day. Do something that's elegant every day. You know, cut up blue jeans, Ugg shoes, may make you feel that you're rebelling. The rebellion may make you feel unworthy because you're always fighting. So every now and then you need to just jump into glamour or something exotic to make you feel just a little different to yourself. You don't have to do it in front of anybody, just to yourself. Try something that, you know, go downtown and rent some gold watches or something and put them on. Rent them. But, and you know, you don't have formals anymore, you know, the long dress and all that kind of stuff. So have yourself a royal ball one day. Go to the cafeteria and say, we will eat nothing but salads or cake, you know. Put some wine in your thermos. Or scotch. But do something that gives you, that confirms your brilliance, confirms your being, confirms your humanity with yourself. That's the struggle, and that's what all, that's what technology, it's wonderful, but it also can reduce you to not. You know, you young ladies, you cannot become Kim Kardashian. Nor do you want to. But you don't know that. You don't know that. If you've got something 24 hours saying, this is the greatest of, this is the greatest of, you know, then you don't know what to do with it because there's no one to say, I don't want that, you know. It's just a beautiful thing. The picture, another thing you may want to do is once a quarter, you may want to have all the students that look at a room like this and just snap a picture and send out a newsletter to other campuses and say, this bees us. You know, we are woke at Highline. Okay? You may want to say that to other, and I don't know whether that's competition or not yet. I tell you, I had to work on that. But you may want to show this. This may be a showcase of the Pacific Northwest. And because it is skin coloring, you should see, well, you see it all the time, but it is different. You know, you're the bluest black and the palest pale in this room right now. That's really a range. Okay. Yes, sir.
Hello.
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 Oh, my God.
We're asking what you said earlier about... about how youth are entitled as teachers. You know, right now, I see a lot of elders, especially for black elders, that, you know, say that the youth of black youth are the lost generation.
Lost generation.
And I had that talk with one of them on a bus, and it was like kind of incredible to hear that because, or not incredible, just like sad. And to go forward, I just want to know your idealization about us and how
we lost views. I sure don't think y'all are lost generation, because I need you. You are now my teacher. I'm now learning from you. I don't know this vocabulary. I don't know those raggedy jeans. I don't know about no UGG shoes. I'm learning. I'm learning to sit and look at some UGG shoes on the front row when I've got on all my jewelry and there's something ugly sticking up toward me. And I've got to sit with this space. She's teaching me. This is my teacher about UGGs. This academic department is the UGG department. So I'll remember that. I'll remember you with locks and wool cap and tied up tennis. What? One tennis shoe is tied.
No, they're not tied. They're not tied. I just do that.
What do you mean?
I do that to my shoes. It's a style, yeah. It's a style. I literally, like, my whole style, like.
Well, I can tell you, I'm complimenting you.
Oh, I didn't know, I was confused.
No, see, that's exactly what I'm saying. I'm complimenting how wonderful you look. You're so used to the negativity, you don't even know how to get a compliment. I'm saying, I'm learning from you, you're my teacher, to be able to look at you and see the gorgeousness of you. You know, and And I'm learning. I mean, this lady got on red shoes and man with a blue denim shirt on and somebody with raggedy denim on and white shoes. It is just wonderful. And this whole row of people, you're able and free enough to discuss your life in front of what we're calling your elders. This is an academic department. What's your major? What's your focus?
What's my major? It's radiology.
Radiology? Mm-hmm. God, what you talking about?
What am I talking about? I mean...
How long? What? You going to stay in this section of the country?
No.
Where are you going to be?
I want to go to HBCU, East Coast, so...
Where do you want to go?
Huh?
Where do you want to go?
Because family's over there, and to be honest, Washington is not, I like Washington, I love it because I was Seattle born, but I want to see other things outside of here.
You all right. Yeah, that's nice. Yes, sir. I saw you move up, sir.
Dr. Mimms.
5 minutes. You just stopped me. Yeah.
May I give you this?
Oh my God, how are you just gonna make me have jewelry the rest of my life? He gives me jewelry every time I see him. My Lord, thank you. It's good to see you too. I told Felix I would bring you. I heard you. I know. Ah!
Can I ask you a quick question, ma'am?
I think so. Oh my God.
First, I want to say thank you for my freedom.
Thank you.
And I want to also echo the gratitude with Professor Ware. Thank you for building a historically black college in the hilltop of Tacoma. Thank you, ma'am. As you know, working in historically white colleges, it can weigh on us as educators of color. And a lot of times, we don't mean to, but sometimes we wound one another because we're trying to navigate whiteness. We're trying to navigate this English language. And sometimes when that happens, because we know it hurts so much to endure racism, that sometimes we don't forgive one another. And my question to you as my elders, how can I make peace with those brothers and sisters who have felt wounded in the struggle that we share together? How do you build again and find each other's humanity again?
Yeah. When you empty yourself, let me tell you about language. If you call a pale person a racist, the identification of that means something is happening in your humanity.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? So I say, racist, ugh. She takes all my time, all of it. She's gone on to the cafeteria, she's done nothing. I'm being depleted by my energy over there. Once you become depleted, you cannot deal with your people of color because your energy is so far over to the paleness of the that there, you have nothing left. We drain ourselves as people of color trying to deal with the language that has nothing to do with us. Just know that it's existing, it's going to be here forever, and what do you have to offer from yourself to others? And once you do that, once you know, beginning today, that every time I see you, you give me 10 more years of my life. Because you put around my neck a piece of jewelry that you've always made. I don't even remember your name. I just remember your touch, your face, and I feel your heart. Why should you spend any time when you're keeping an older black woman gorgeous with jewelry around her neck? Why should you spend any time worried about a historical white college when around my neck you're turning me into a historical black college? That's the language you all have given me. I didn't give that. So you've got to understand your own elegance. And that's a scary thing, you all, to be proud of yourself, to go inside. Outside, cool, but going inside is hell. Because you've got to recognize it, that I'm worthy. You know what I mean? To just get up every morning and go to bed every night saying, hey, and still I rise, hey. Just try it. You got it. You're all right. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Is this it? Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Hi. I want to say first what an honor it is to meet you. And then second, my name is Angel. And I'm a single parent by choice. And it's evident that I'm African American. So I never had the privilege. I'm from Oakland, California. My community was called the Lower Bottom. So I never had the privilege to Black Lives Matter type of thing. You know, I had to raise my son up. And so I'm here leading by example. And I dropped out of school in the sixth grade, and I had to empower myself to come here. And so while I'm standing here empowered, I hold this sense of strength, and it's hard for me to accept what it is here that I can accept because of such a strong demeanor, it tends to intimidate some people. And in order for me to receive what they have to give, I have to come with the strength that I have. And when I notice that they've taken a tone back to my strength, then I draw a weakening sense of demeanor, which makes me cry, because they seem to think that I'm here to take over or to be forceful, but I'm not here like that. I'm just here aggressively trying to get the knowledge that I can get to take back to an empowerment group I'm starting called God's Girls Get Up. So I don't care what color you are or how bad you feel, it's time to make a change. And so with that being said, a lot of people don't want to help me. But I'm like, no, I need what you have, and you don't understand. And I'm not here to take what they have. I want to get it. But how do I come with not a weakened demeanor, but a strong sense of
What is your major? What's your focus?
Well, here right now, I'm majoring in educating myself. I'm educating myself What's your,
Don't trap yourself. What is your focus?
My focus is people, my son. My son's 25.
Hold it. Tomorrow or this afternoon, go in the registration department or the curriculum department and find if they have a school of drama here. Put yourself in any drama class and take every bit of that greatness that you have and turn it into your own script. You can't fight your own theater. You can't fight your own story. We all have multiple stories, and you've got some tremendous ones. What's your name?
My name's Angel.
Angel, I will come back to one of your first plays that Angel Theater presents. Okay. Thank you. Thank you all. Is that right? I'm through. Right. Thank you.
So, everyone, can y'all please give it up again for Dr. Maxine Mimms?
Thank you. Thank you.